Thank you. I will share it again. Do you see my screen?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, great. So, okay. Yeah. Okay.
It's okay.
Okay. Hello, everybody. So I'm very happy to be here. And thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. I should say it's a presentation that is less technical than the previous ones, and it's a contribution which is based on several papers made by many people, so I cannot quote everybody, but we will have the links at the end of the presentation. If you like the papers and the figures I show, you can read them and identify the contribution of each of my colleagues. Of course, this is my own views and not the one of the Banque de France or the ACPR. So this is a roadmap, a short introduction, second part on the way we measure the concern for internet users during the COVID crisis. Third part, which is dedicated to the effects of the lockdown on physical measures, I would say. Fourth part is dedicated to an experimentation we made on measuring house prices during the COVID crisis, and I will afterwards conclude. Some words for introduction. Of course, we know that due to the multifaceted nature, the COVID crisis has triggered major shifts in economic activity and household behavior in particular. To analyze these trends, many institutions, such as the Banque de France, have made use of high frequency data. I will define the way we use the high frequency data later on. This has allowed to get around the problem of the long publication times for official statistics and rapidly measure the impact of the economic shock. It has also helped to provide real-time insight into household behavior and expectation. I will show you how afterwards, and to identify their main concerns alongside those of the business community. So the so-called open data we used during the COVID crisis and we still use, and I will show you in this presentation, are the three main features. The first one is that they are not included in the official statistics published by institutions and authorities, and the Banque de France especially. Second, they can be accessed easily and free of charge via the internet. And third, they are available at a high frequency, generally at least daily. So in practice, these statistics are derived from social media platforms, such as Twitter, from the internet, such as Google searches, or they are granular open data on the web, such as statistics linked to energy, transportation, the real estate. I will show you a more specific example afterwards, and other matters. Of course, this is not fully original, because open data proved extremely useful during the COVID crisis for tracking fluctuations in economic activity. We have the data from bank card, as we showed just before, electricity consumption, weekly unemployment figures, and real-time location of global cargo ships, for instance, and satellite data, such as the examples that I will also elaborate on afterwards. What is more, Google data, for instance, have proven very useful for forecasting and forecasting the first 4 weeks of the quarter. So it echoes to some extent what was said just before. We have a paper here at the Banque de France. We show that it's very useful to use Google data to forecast the first 4 weeks or even 5 weeks of the quarter. But the comparative advantage of this data vanished afterwards. So it's a figure that we can remember. So my presentation reviews the selection of the indicators that we use at the Banque de France and focuses in particular on the household behavior and on the global economy. So first, the way we measure the effect of the crisis on consumer confidence to some extent. We have the history of global Google searches from the keyword coronavirus, which shows on the left-hand side a big spike in volumes in China from the end of January 2020, then in South Korea here, and in Italy from the end of February, and other countries from the middle of March, which is a clear sequence that we know related to the spread of the pandemics into the world. We look at the Google searches for symptoms and testing for COVID, and we see that there is also a clear pattern depending on the news and the information that the people try to get on some issues related to the health crisis and some disputes as well related to chloroquine, masks, and hand sanitizers, for instance. You have this on the right hand side, which is very interesting because it shows to some extent, and it's very much related. This is what we try to assess. It is very much related to confidence, in fact, and consumer confidence during this period. So it's a very insightful indicators. Banque de France is also responsible for the assessment of over indebtedness in France, and so we were very interesting to know whether people were looking at over indebtedness in Google searches, and maybe more in the lockdown than before. So we looked at the Google searches for the word over indebtedness in France. So this figure. And you see that, surprisingly, we have no spike following the lockdown. The lockdown in France was the 17th of March. So we have no clear upward trend in the Google searches for over indebtedness. But afterwards, close to the end of the lockdown, so it was a bit strange. So we tried to figure out why. And our interpretation is that the physical restrictions imposed during the lockdown appear to have discouraged households from seeking information over indebtedness. But with the length of the lockdown, this has weighted heavily on their finances, especially for the most vulnerable households. And a month after the start of the lockdown, the issue resurfaces. So we have here the spike here. And when we compare the Google searches for indebtedness and the two applications for indebtedness files in France, there is clearly this spike 2 months afterwards. And this is clearly, this Google searches is clearly a leading indicator for the true over indebtedness files applications in France. So this is very interesting to look at these figures. What we did also is to look at the communication of the main French businesses. So we looked at the Twitter accounts of the largest French corporations, which is a representative of the SBF 120, which is one of the most important stock indexes in France. And we see here how these firms communicate on having economic difficulties. This is the blue line, and having economic difficulties linked with the COVID crisis. This is the green line here. So, for instance, in April, 40% of the main French firms communicated on having economic difficulties linked with the COVID crisis, which is very much, and which is a very interesting, according to us, very interesting information on the stress on the firms. Second part, the effects of the lockdown are real and can be measured physically. So we already spoke about the Google Mobility Index, but I think it's very interesting to look at what happened in France. We looked at how movement to leisure sites and places of work moved during the lockdown, and they fell in fact by 85% after the lockdown. This is the left hand side figure here. After the lockdown was lifted, mobility increased, but in June, after the end of the lockdown, it was still 30% below its baseline level here at the end of the figures. Another interesting open data that we look is air pollution, corrected for the impact of temperatures and other factors, of course. Also declined with the introduction of the lockdown. This is here in Paris. Nitrogen dioxide pollution dropped well below historical levels, reflecting the stoppage of industrial sites and a portion of transportation activity. If we look at the share of consumption with different eating items, we also, this is the left-hand side figure here, we look at Google searches linked with different components of consumer spending. Of course, we show that they dropped sharply following the lockdown in the categories leisure and transportation. This is the green part here of the figures and the violet one. Conversely, the category food and tobacco hit a peak in popularity at the time of the lockdown, which may reflect the panic buying of some parts of the households to stockpile goods. Tourism, which is a very important part of GDP in France as well, also collapsed. We look at the number of new reviews of Airbnb platform in Paris, and at the start of the lockdown, we have a sharp decrease, which amounts to even 99% in comparison with the previous level, meaning that this type of activity evaporated. Unlike the other indicators, which increased again once the lockdown was lifted, this one remained flat at end April due to the continuing shutdown on the tourist industry. And we know that this had permanent effects as well on tourism activity. Another feature is that the indicators also make it possible to analyze the different stages of the lockdown in each country. I think this one is interesting because we had a very gradual return to normal in China as of end March 2020. After a very sharp drop, pollution returned to its pre-crisis level in Wuhan at the start of June. Air traffic also began to rise again as of end February. Also, it was still 30% below its pre-crisis level in June 2020. So this is the chart that we looked at also. I don't want to spend too much time on this because I would like to show you some points on the real estate experimentation we made. So this is an example here of the discrepancy in intra-country, I would say, regional discrepancies inside the country. We have on the left-hand side pollution in China, depending on different regions. So you can see that there are some discrepancies in the Beijing, which is the blue line, and the Wuhan region, which is the green line. And on the right hand side, you have the Google Mobility Index for different states in the United States. And as you can see, there is a striking contrast between the first federal states to be affected by the lockdown, which were New York and California, and others where the lockdown was introduced later on for a shorter duration and with less stringent rules. The COVID crisis was also an opportunity for us to invest on the house prices web scraping data. So, of course, we had no information or few information on official statistics, and we were interested to get some information from other sources. So there is a lot of really accessible granular information, which can be collected in real time from real estate websites using waste collection techniques. We use the United Kingdom as an example because we had more data than in France, and they were more accessible, I would say, than in France. But this illustrates the value of daily granular and real-time databases. So the data are extracted through a daily automatic upload of data on the internet from the major real estate sites in the UK, Rightmove, Zoopla, and on the market. We add some other regions, Northern Ireland and Scotland. Through these websites, we have more than 1 million real estate listings downloaded on average every day, corresponding to the total stock of available listings. This data confirms that during the first lockdown period, activity stalled and sellers adopted a wait-and-see attitude. I will show you some charts afterwards. And the granular approach also reveals significant regional differences. While advertised prices were stable or even increased after the first lockdown in more rural areas, it declined continuously in London. So I begin with the right-hand side chart. So you can see here the evolution of the average listing prices by region, and you can see here the downward trends in London, which is very clear, while the prices remain stable. Yeah, 2 minutes. Okay. So I jump to the conclusion. High frequency indicators can provide very interesting information on their own, supplementing existing indicators with additional or more immediate data, or be used to estimate other variables such as production, consumption, GDP, using some econometric methods. What are the ongoing issues related to this point in France, among the France? First is to assess the added value in normal times and link this high frequency data with more conventional economic variables. So we have a lot of experiments ongoing linked to truck transportation, for instance, to measure international commerce, or to use Google Trends on credit consumption to anticipate the future evolution of credit, which is very interesting and crucial for Banque de France. We have also IT and legal matters for collecting, maintaining, and releasing high frequency data. And we invest on new avenues. So we try to use satellite data to assess climate risk exposures on insurance companies and to assess the building activity. Second, we use social media sentiment to gauge inflation expectation, and it works well. In fact, we get some information and some additional information related to what we get from traditional surveys, which is very interesting in assessing inflation expectation from households. And finally, we use web scrape data to gauge the risk on financial actors, for instance, real estate transaction negotiation margins, or assess the reputational risk on some financial actors. I thank you for your attention. I have the links with the papers on which my presentation was based, if you are interested in. Thank you very much.